Praise the Lord. Today we look into a scripture portion from the Gospel of John. Please turn your scripture to the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses from 21 to 30. We read responsively. The Gospel according to John, chapter 13, verses from 21 to 30. When Jesus had said these things, he was troubled in spirit and testified and said, "Most assuredly I say to you, one of you will betray me." Then the disciples looked at one another, perplexed about whom he spoke. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples, whom Jesus loved. Simon Peter therefore motioned to him to ask who it was of whom he spoke. Then leaning back on Jesus' breast, he said to him, "Lord, who is it?"
Jesus answered, "He it is to whom I shall give a sop when I have dipped it." And when he had dipped the sop, gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon.
Now after the piece of bread, Satan entered him. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you do? Do quickly."
Now no man
at the table knew for what reason he said this to him. For some thought, because Judas had the money box, that Jesus had said to him, "Buy those things we need for the feast," or that he should give something to the poor. This is the piece of bread.
Went immediately out, and it was night.
Okay, let us pray. Loving gracious Father, thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord, for this wonderful Lord's Day. As Lord, as we are celebrating your Lord's Day, Lord, we are here to look into your scripture. Yes, Lord, open your scripture and speak to us. And reveal to us the truth, the treasure, the living word. Yes, Lord, prepare us, each one of us, to receive a word and meditate on it and to apply in our life. Yes, Lord, I also pray that I'm not worthy to stand here. I'm a man of unclean lips, unclean heart. Lord, you sanctify me and enable me and give me your grace so that, Lord, I can speak your word clearly, precisely, and boldly. Thank thee, praise thee. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Good to see you all. We are all excited to be here in the house of God. As we are celebrating the Lord's Day, hopefully all of us are excited, right? But I didn't see it sound, doesn't sound like people are not that excited. Because when we wanted to read the scripture, we asked to read alternatively, but nobody was reading the scripture. It was so silent. So today I'm here share a portion from the Gospel, chapter 13. Maybe it's an important portion, I guess, but I'm totally undeserved to be here. But God gives grace to share His word. Recently, I made an offer to a house, which is in Fremont, and for 1.1 million. But the seller decided to give the house to somebody who willing to offer 250k more than the listing price. Then my daughter Sarah asked me, "Daddy, did you get the house?" No, I told no, no, Sarah ma, I couldn't, because somebody paid me more. Somebody paid more than what I offered. Said, "How come, Daddy? How come you cannot pay that much when other people are able to pay that much?" The same way that Sarah was the other day, she was asking, "Daddy, are you not going to preach? No, I'm not that a good preacher. I need to preach. No, Daddy, how come? When other people are preaching, how come you are not preaching? So you should also preach. I'm sure Sarah will be excited, happy to see on the YouTube as soon as it's posted. And if brother is not giving me a chance, probably Sarah might ask brother, why you are not giving my daddy to preach when other people are preaching here? Okay, anyway, we come to the scripture portion. So today it's a very familiar portion. It's everybody pretty much knows. The portion that we read is the betrayal of Judas. So we are going to just look at the Judas betrayal today, and probably we will draw some important points to apply into our life as well. Here in this chapter, what we have seen is the disciples and Jesus are enjoying the Passover feast, right? Food and talking, sharing, fellowshipping, and enjoying the time, a good time they have. All of a sudden, there is a great surprise to the disciple that when Jesus saying this word, when Jesus had said these things, he was troubled in spirit and testified and said, "Most assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me." So nobody would expected in that situation when they were the time of fellowship and having a good time with Christ and the disciples and the friends, a joyful occasion. Everybody might have shocked. How come that he's saying? Because the group is very small, only 12 people. So not many. So he said very clearly, said one of you. So everybody is kind of wondering, and the scene completely changed. They were happy that time, but all of a sudden they were all worried and saddened in their heart. It says the scripture we see, it's they are the 22 says, "Then the disciple looked at one another, perplexed about whom he spoke." They were wondering and looking at each other, who is going to be? It's betraying the Lord, our Lord, our Master. Is that they were worried and concerned, and we were reading that even the other the gospel book from Matthew and Luke as well, it talks about they were quarreling, they were maybe fighting each other and finger pointing one another. Then maybe you might be the one, or I am not the one, or somebody might be the one. But nobody knows except Christ who is the real betrayer is. Right? That's why they were wondering and perplexed and looking at surprise. So that is what that the situation is. But Judas, so today we are going to talk more about Judas, his characters and attributes and things like this. How come he went on betraying the Lord, who is, to him, he spent almost 3.5 years in his Christ ministry and end up betraying Christ to the enemy of Christ. So Judas was introduced in the chapter when we read the gospel, chapter 12. And also the same story is happening in Matthew as well, Matthew chapter 26. When we read the first few verses from Gospel of John chapter 12, from 1 to 6, we read a small story that after Jesus raised his friend Lazarus, they were at their home and maybe having a feast. Christ and his disciples were invited for the feast, and the Mary, Martha and Lazarus arranging a hosting a feast for Jesus and his disciples. After the meal, and Mary poured a costly oil, a spikenard, to anoint Jesus' feet. That's the time here we see the character of Judas is first introduced in the Gospel of John. They were, the chapter 12:4 says, but one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box, and he used to take what was put in it. So this is the first time that Judas was introduced the Gospel of John. Here what we see is John talks about his character. He is the one holding the money box, and also he is a thief, because he was stealing from the money that people put him in the money box. So from this we know Judas Iscariot is a thief. He's always cared about the worldly things, the love for money, the greed for money, right? And also he's a dishonest person. He's not a trustworthy person. But why Judas is carrying the money box? And even though he's not a worthy person to carry the money box, right? Maybe to carry the money box, the worthy person in the disciple group might be maybe the disciple John, because whom Christ loved him the most. Or it could be Levi. Levi has experience. He's handling the financial matters. He's a treasurer, right? So he might be the eligible person to handle the treasury. Or even Nathanael. So even Jesus testified to him that he is a man who knows, he's a good Israelite with no deceit. But Jesus maybe purposefully, deliberately, he gave the treasury responsibility to Iscariot, because Jesus knew him, his heart, where his heart is. So the person who is to handle the treasury is the person maybe who is a more greedy or evil. So here also we handle money in the church, because the congregation gives money to support the ministry and help the people and help the congregation. The same way the old days also people might have given their, because Jesus is in the ministry for 3.5 years, and people might have given their portions to support his ministry while they're for their travel and the food and other things. So that's why they're carrying the money box, the money purse. But that is with Judas, unfortunately. But Judas is actually what we are seeing is he's a thief, and whatever the money is that been put in that money box, he's been secretly encroaching it, swindling the money from the money box. So from that we know he is a dishonest person and not a trustworthy person. And also his heart is always is on the money. But if you notice Judas, even though he is such a evil man, in his heart, and also he want to associate with the people who are godly. So he looks, he's serving God, right? Because he's with the disciples, and Christ, the Son of Man, the Son of God, who is proclaiming the gospel. Somehow he's also want to associate with his people, and but in other words, inward, he was very much interested in the worldly things. His heart is always on the money and his greediness. So Christ taught us that where we have to keep our heart. So not in the worldly things, not in the worldly richness, but Christ even taught, probably even Judas also learned from Christ, that from his teaching, where he has to keep his heart. So when we read the Matthew Gospel chapter 6, 19, 21, Christ teaches to the people and the disciples, do not lay up yourself treasure on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourself treasure in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. Right. So we are the people of God. We know we are serving God, and our desires and motive and our heart towards the heavenly treasures, not on the earthly treasures. That's what Christ is teaching, where we have to give an importance. We have to, not on the earthly treasures, but on the heavenly treasures. That is, should be in our focus. But Judas, as a thief, his heart is set on the worldly treasures, trying to become rich by stealing money from the money is given to the missionary. And also, Judas is trying to serve two masters. So one master is clearly he want to be associated with the people of God and be with God and pretending to do the ministry of God. And also at the same time, his heart is always on to be rich and for his self motivation. That's where Jesus' heart, Judas is always. The love for the worldly possessions. Jesus clearly told, no one can serve two masters. Matthew chapter 6, 24, Jesus talks about, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. There is no way to serve God and the world. If you have a love for the world, and at the same time you cannot love for God. But Judas is trying to be on both the side. But it's not going to happen, because he cannot travel in two boats at the same time, because each boat goes in different directions. But he ends up in falling in the water. And this also, Paul is warning even the Philippian church, that even some of the, he has continued to plead the church, why you cannot serve the world and Christ. As a Christians, we are We cannot serve the world and Christ. If you look at the epistle of Philippians, the letter, Paul's letter to Philippians, chapter 3, verse 18 to 20, where Paul says, some of you, they walked as in a, they only care about themselves. They live for to fill their belly, not to live in a Christian life. They live in a hypocrisy. He says, for many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on earthly things. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. So we cannot, as a Christians, we cannot serve the two masters. So we have to focus on the heavenly things, because Paul clearly says our citizenship is not on the earthly matters, the earthly possession, in the earthly richness. But some of you, in among you, there are people, they are professing to be Christians and preaching the gospel, but yet they try to please their own self-interest. They want to live for their life. For them, the heavenly things, it doesn't matter. They live like a people, anybody else in this world. They're focusing on the earthly matters. But as a Christians, we are encouraged and to, as so we are the people of, our citizenship is in heaven. So we have to conduct and live a life that is not as like Judas, as he was just trying to fulfill his own self-pleasure, to fulfill his belly. So we are very encouraged by the Paul pleading that we are to, as a people, that as a Christians, as we have to live in our citizenship is in heaven. Now the same way that even Jesus also in talked about when a young ruler, the rich young ruler come to Jesus, when he come and asked Jesus, how come I can inherit the eternal life? And Jesus replied to him that you should follow the commandments. You go and follow the commandments, and then you can have the eternal life. It talks about in the gospel, Matthew chapter 19, 16, 22. He come and says, good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but God. That is God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. He said to him, which one? Jesus said, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The young man said to him, all these things I have kept from my youth. What do I still lack? And Jesus replied, if you want to be perfect, go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasures in heaven, and come follow me. They say, rich young ruler, he said, I'm following pretty much all the commandments, but what I still lack. And Jesus know his heart. His heart is not on the heavenly things. He just want to have an eternal life by for whatever the mean that he thinks in his mind. But his heart is a heart desire on the worldly possession. But when Jesus told him, go and sell your possession to the poor, then you will have treasures in heaven and and follow me. But the verse 22 says, but the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. So when you have heart desire, your heart is on the worldly possession, it shows it's very, very difficult to have the eternal life and to be a Christian and follow Christ. So this man felt so sorrowful because he doesn't want to lose his richness. He doesn't want to lose his sacrifice, his comfort that he is in. He doesn't want to give his possession, to leave his possession. So that's Judas also demonstrated his possession, because his possession is in the worldly things, so that he cannot come to the kingdom of God, taste the love of God. Right? So let's move on to the we all know Judas is a thief and his heart is not right, and he is trying to serve two masters, the worldly thing and the trying to serve God. And it is very clear that we cannot serve two masters. There is no way that when you have a heart in the worldly possessions, we cannot please God. And also Judas is a dishonest man, because people trusted him, and disciple and Jesus trusted him, so that's why they gave the treasury to him, right? But Judas is constantly swindling money from the money box. Maybe he's building his rich secretly, right? Maybe he's buying a motorbike. Maybe those days there is no motorbike, but now that's why when we see people and lot of even hear all the lot of stories, we can hear lot of scandals in the churches, and people, the preachers, they preach their prosperity gospel, and at the end up in accumulating lot of wealth and buying private jet and things, then end up in lot of scandal. They come at us in a flash news in the TV. Right. So back in India also, we see a lot of people. The people come to, they want to come to Christianity. They think that somehow they can make money and to become rich. So it's an easy way to make money. They don't need to work so hard. And all you need to be just to profess and say that I'm a Christian, I'm a pastor, a teacher, and doing all these mission works. And go to people, you can collect money. That's a lot of people in India, like a lot of preachers, they are so rich. In I know some in Tirunelveli, there are preachers nowadays, the most of the pastors, they are the real estate agents. So they'll do the all the real estate, help their congregation to buy houses and sell their property. So you know what, how the real estate agent, right? And here or there, they need to they need to lie and cheat, and they need to do all the things. But a lot of even professing Christians, they say, but there, they clearly, their the motivation, that the dishonesty. See, for us, God has given, God trusted us, and we are responsible for handling the treasury, and people take that money and use their personal pleasure, personal building their wealth. It's a dishonest, it's a betrayal to God when God is giving that responsibility to the people, his people. So there are a lot of, sadly, a lot of our in Christianity people, should come for various wrong motives. Maybe Jesus, Judas has also came with a wrong motive to be why he want to be part of the Jesus ministry, right? So he just want to have a fame and success because he just because of course Christ is a famous in that time, and maybe Judas also want to be part of that for the social status and some recognitions. But it's very sad that even a lot of Christians, they are professing Christians being in the church, and so there is no honesty. But God knows your heart. Christ clearly knows what is the heart of Judas Iscariot. Even though the other people are not noticing it, and Christ clearly knows the heart of Judas. Right? So God expects, as a Christian, we have to show honesty to the responsibility that God has given to us. And also, God checks our motives. If it is a wrong motive, God knows the wrong motive will be punished, definitely. So Judas is clearly a dishonest man and came to Christ with a wrong motive for his personal advantage. And to also, Judas lived in a hypocrisy life. Right? Think about Judas. Judas was with Christ for 3.5 years with his disciples. None of them, like, except Christ, none of them seems to know who is real Judas is. They're not able to know his heart. What is his intention? What is his motive? He's completely lived a hypocrisy life among his the disciples in the church with Christ, right? That's why even Christ, when he was saying that someone who is going to betray me, they're not able to guess, even they're not able to identify Jesus, the one he's going to betray. Even then, when we read like verse 26 onwards, Jesus answered, "It is he to whom I shall give a piece of bread when I have dipped it." And he, having dipped to the bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. And now after the piece of bread, Satan entered him. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you do? Do quickly." But the next verse says, "But some thought, because Judas had the money box, that Jesus had said to him, 'Buy those things we need for the feast,' that he should give something to the poor." So he's still, they're not able to recognize Judas is the one that he's going to betray Jesus. They were still thinking about something else. Or still thinking about themselves, maybe. Right? So Judas absolutely maintained a complete extreme hypocrisy so that nobody can recognize that his internal motive, the intention, right? Here, even the other gospel, we see before even that feast, even Judas went to the Pharisees and the high priest to make a deal with them. He had already negotiated with them the deal that for the 30 pieces of silver, I will show the man that you are looking for, right? So God knows, Christ knows his heart, who is going to betray. But these people, the people, the disciples, they're not able to recognize because he's living in complete hypocrisy. It's always true, even people professing Christians like us, that we can live in absolute hypocrisy, that none of us can identify one another. They may not know my motive, what is in my motive, my heart, but I can still live in hypocrisy. This Judas lived in hypocrisy, that people, the disciples couldn't figure out his the intention, the reason, his characters, his behaviors. Maybe outwardly he looks, when he is in the midst of the people, he acted so nice, right? He looks very, maybe he dressed up nice and talk nice, speak nice, and everything, all the appearance, outside appearance, from his speech, maybe his fun time to spend time with, he's a nice person to spend time with, but he lived in hypocrisy. He hid his original character from the other disciples, other friends who was very close to him. The same thing would happen in the church as well, right? We also can live, any one of us can live in absolute hypocrisy, hide ourselves, that so the other people of the congregation can notice that we are, our motives are evil and our attitudes towards sin is not clearly seen. Nowadays, if you ask many of the professing Christians, they will say, are you a Christian? Yes, they will say, I'm a Christian. And if you ask deep, they might reveal that I like one of the street preacher, the Ray Comfort, that you all might familiar. He goes with the street and asks all these hard questions upfront their face. A lot of people, they say, I am a Christian. So you are a born-again Christian? Yes, I am a born-again Christian. You go to church? I go to church. You read Bible? Yes, I read Bible. Then he go to the hardest questions, direct questions. And he says, ask you, do you lie? That is the ninth commandment of God. And they will say, yes, I lie. And so are you still a born-again Christian? Yes, I am a born-again Christian. So do you steal? I may not steal. Then he go on deep on asking very deep, very humiliating questions. Like, do you watch pornography? Most of them say, born again Christians, they say, watch pornography. And how come a born again Christian, professing Christians, can do all such a things? Even we can, in that kind of act, we'll be doing. If we are doing, we are guilty of. We are guilty before our Lord, and we are dishonest. We are dishonest to the people who are really seeing your face and spending time with you. And if you, in your heart, if you live in an extreme hypocrisy, that you are in danger. And he warns, and he brings out the scripture, sometimes he says, the epistle of Corinthians, Paul talks about very clearly about the hypocrites, the people who do such a sin. And do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexual, nor sodomites, neither thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revelers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. Right? The professing Christians also can be any one of this. Paul is mentioning the sin. And Paul warns that if you are a liar, if you are a thief, if you are a fornicator, if you are an adulterer, if you are a drunkard, covetous, rivalers, that you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Right? So, where are we? Are we still professing Christian? Are we still lying? Probably if you recomfort here, maybe ask everyone else questions. Many of us might be guilty in front of him. Right? But as a Christian, we are turned away from all this sin. The secret sins that we treasure in our heart. It's clearly a betrayal to Christ that we don't want to continue live in such a kind of immoral life. Outward appearance, we look very polished and nice, but even none of us can, even they can doubt us and know us, but we can be in the danger of this kind of sins, and we can, any one of us can live in this hypocrisy. If you live in this hypocrisy, and Paul wants that those people will not inherit the kingdom of God, and we don't want to be in such a shame. And because Judas, being a, he's a thief, there is no way Judas has a space in the kingdom of God. And we know that what kind of the end that Judas faced, right? He had the shameful death. He betrayed Christ, the Son of Man, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, just for the 30 pieces of silver. So what happened at the end to him? So he was living greed of money. His heart is on money. And finally he was possessed with a Satan. So that greediness took over him. And when and betrayed Christ, that he spent almost 3.5 years, and he walked with him, lived with him, ate with him, shared with him. He met brother, one of the privileged person that he spent like 3.5 years with a direct preaching of Christ. But yet his heart didn't change. He lived in the same, the motive, the wrong motive, to just to the worldly treasures. That heart, his heart is always on the worldly treasure. And he lived in hypocrisy, hiding himself, his heart, from the other disciples, so that people know, even in a any mean that anybody can doubt him. But he sold Christ, the eternal King, one who came down to save the sinner, even to him. He sold the master to the enemy who are trying to kill Jesus, just for 30 pieces of silver and with a kiss. So did he enjoy that 30 pieces of silver? He's not able to enjoy the 30 pieces of silver even. Right? As soon as Judas heard that they are going to crucify Christ, and he felt guilty and came and threw the money to the people who gave the money to him. But that's too late. And Satan took his life, and he had a shameful death. He has to hung himself. So not only the money that he thought that he can enjoy and thought that he can keep that money for himself, he end up losing everything. He end up losing the money, also end up losing his life. That's why when we live our life not pleasing to God and pleasing to Satan, and Satan knows, and he will took the control of you. He will took the control of you, and he make you miserable, and your life will be miserable. But if you don't turn and realize and come to a repentance, change your heart towards Christ, the end is, we know that the end is also same as what happened to Judas, right? See, Judas also has the same access to what other disciple had. The other disciple also spend enough, the same amount of time what Judas spent with Christ. Judas also, the other disciple also heard what Judas heard. Judas have seen what Christ has performed. Christ performed miracles. We have seen like recently, Christ raised Lazarus from the dead. Christ healed the blind man. Christ healed the lepers and sick and the lame. He saw all those things. Like the other disciples. But Judas remains still in his unrepented heart that went on betraying Christ, and then at the end he faced the shameful death. So when you compare with the Pharisees, we know they are, at least openly, they are hypocrites, right? They're openly trying to kill Christ. Pharisees, the enemy, they consider Christ as an enemy because they wanted to kill Christ for whatever the reasons that we see. But here Judas, he's with them, but he is also became an enemy with him. Even though he had the same access, same closeness like other disciples, but his heart is not on the heavenly treasures. He doesn't really care about the things of God. He sowed things on the worldly treasures. So if you sow to the worldly things, you will reap the corruptions. We see it in Galatians chapter 6. 78. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. Judas reaped to his flesh the worldly treasures. He put his heart on the worldly treasures. So he reaped corruption. If you and me put our, when we are sowing our motives and energy into the worldly things, and its word is very clear that we will reap corruptions. If you show to your flesh, the flesh shall reap corruption. If you show to your, the spirit, the spirit will reap eternal life. So today, this morning, we are encouraged to sow where we are sowing. Where is our motive? Are we honest with God, that God has given to us? The responsibility that God has given to us. God checks the internal, our hearts and thoughts. Where is our motives? So if your motive is wrong, you need to repent. We need to change and come to the living God. One who paid the price on the cross. One who sacrificed for our sins. Get right with God. Today is a day that we need to right with God. If you are not right, repent and make an absolute turn away from sin. As a Christian, we don't want to live in hypocrisy. That's why the early Christians, I like that when we say, talked about, they even shared one another. They poured out their heart to the other brothers. They know each other very deep. So that is all about the fellowship. When we spend time together, we should know each other. So when we also, sometimes we'll fall in sin, it's good to know sometime because they can correct. They can warn us. They can help us to stay away from the sin. But rather what is happening is we are taking extreme effort to hide ourselves. So when we are here, we completely are different. But when we go away from here, we are maybe completely opposite of. Sometimes I am one of the guilty of person. It's hurt to the core. Because we don't want to in that position. We don't want to live in that conditions. Because the word is very clear and the warning is very clear. Neither liars or fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, homosexuals, sodomists, thieves, extortion will inherit the kingdom of God. We don't want in the wrath of God. We don't want to abide in the wrath of God. God redeemed us from all this curse, all this wrath. Because of this, the wrath of God was upon us. That's what Paul is encouraging, that stay away from the wrath. So the sons of disobedience. Once we were disobedient people, once we were practicing such a kind of things, but God redeemed us, bought us from those things and came to the glorious gospel. And so we need to live as a people of God, the glorious people, not the glory of shame like Judas lived. So today, this evening, we are asked to encourage to look into our heart, where we stand before God. Are we living in absolute hypocrisy? So that nobody can even notice, nobody can even see. It's better to reveal our heart to our brothers, our elders. That's why early Christians, they were opening their heart. They know each other very deep enough. At the core, they know. That's the idea of the fellowship. So that we know one another. We know each one's weakness. And correct them. Rebuke them. But when we live in a hiding hypocrisy, if we end up living in the same condition, we end up losing the great gift, the price that God is interested for us. So are we still living that kind of sins? Are we, as professing Christians, are we still lying? Professing Christian, are we still stealing in any means? Professing Christians, are we living in secret sins, fornication, adultery? Stay away from all those things. Paul says, it's not even mentioned among the saints, among you. Such a thing should not be even mentioned among the people of God. It should not be mentioned. That kind of expectation from the God's people. So this evening, this afternoon, we are asked to look into our heart and check where we stand. Are we honest with Christ in all things God has given to us? Or are we swindling His money? Check our motives. What is our motives? Why we are being a Christian? Is it because of the social status that we are being a Christian? Or is it because we get some benefit out of being in Christian, in the church? So it's a time to examine our heart, our motives, where we stand before Christ. In Christ 1, even Matthew chapter 15, 8, 9, it says, "These people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me, and in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men." So where are we? Where is our heart? Are we close enough? Are we close to God in our heart? Are we simply professing in our lips that we are Christians and we are worshipping the great God? We may stand away from God in our actions, in our heart's conditions. So we have seen today the betrayal of Judas and the motives of Judas, where he is, what is his motives, how he lost the glory like the other disciples enjoyed. The other disciples received the eternal life, the kingdom of God, and went on professing Christ and witnessing Christ and testifying Christ. Rather, Judas had a shameful death. So let's look into the Lord by these thoughts. So we don't want to be deceived. Like Judas was deceived by the Satan. He lived in hypocrisy. He lived in wrong motive. His deeds were evil, even though he found in the midst of the people of God. Loving Heavenly Father, we come to Thee. Lord, thanks for enabling us to look into Your Scripture. Yes, Lord, help us to examine our heart in the light of Scripture. Lord, where we stand before Thee. Lord, we can be professing Christians, but Lord, we still live in extreme hypocrisy. Lord, and professing one thing and doing another thing. If that is the case, Lord, help us, Lord, to turn our heart and mind towards the Savior, the one who died on the cross for our sin. Lord, You cleanse us, sanctify us. Lord, help us be honest. Help us to, Lord, live as we appear outside. Help us to, Lord, live with what we have in the heart. Lord, we pray, Lord, help us not to betray You in any means. Lord, if we live in our continue to live in sin, like the former life, if we conduct the same way the former life, Lord, the wrath abides in us. Neither liar nor thief, the fornicators, adulterers, revelers, drunkards cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Help us, Lord, to examine and forsake the sins that should not be named among the saints. Live us a life to pleasing unto thee. Give us your grace and strengthen us. I commit all of us in this time in your hand. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. May the love of God.